budget committee meeting on Monday, August 10th, 2015, and we will call the meeting to order. We will dispense with roll call. I believe the clerk has obtained that. And move right into committee discussion of the budget. And tonight we are going to start with Parks and Recreation. And Bill Lockwood will be leading us through there. Bill, take her over. And
thank you, Mr. Chairman. Along with me is Marty Miller. Marty is immediate past vice president of the commission, has been on for several years, so pleased to have him here this evening. I don't think any of the other commission members could make it this evening. So just to briefly recap budget overall, there are no major changes within the budget this year as far as no additional permanent staff are requested, and no major changes in facility schedules or operating seasons. And the budget as presented to you does include all of the other cost of living, health insurance increases, and other items that were across the board prepared by the finance department that impact on all departments. In front of you are a few handouts that we'll get into later. That two of those are fairly substantial major changes that have come up since the budget was submitted to the city administrator, and we can review those in a few minutes. The top sheet of that handout was the kind of the recap of the Parks and Recreation items that had a 5% or more change from prior year budget that inquiry was made at a previous budget work session. And just kind of looking down through there, most of those are related either to our long-range stewardship plan. Some of them involve the multi-purpose building operation coming online, and others are changes due to the capital improvements program or changes in our pink sheet items from prior years as we address the replacement of vehicles and various pieces of equipment. So if there's any questions on any of those at the moment, I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have on those particular items.
Councilman Scribner.
Mr. Lockwood.
Yes. Yeah. I believe it is 65.
So it's all been paid
right
to date.
They usually transfer that right at the start of the fiscal year.
Okay. All right. I'm just trying to understand. So you're saying that the increase that's been approved is 28.5 for the year?
Correct.
Okay. All right. That was the first thing I saw, and I was curious about that. I'll let some other people ask questions.
Any other questions before Bill moves on?
The other items I put in front of you, a couple of our program guides, the one that just came out a week or so ago and the prior one, that'll give you a full rundown of all the various programs and activities that are funded by the budget. But I did mention a couple of additional items. There's another landscape printed page before you this evening. That talks about some line item amendments. Two major things that have happened since the budget was prepared and submitted were obviously the acquisition of the Greenberry Acres property that you all were supportive of. And then secondly, our previous Park Commission meeting, the Commission voted to establish a tennis partnership fund and set aside some funding in that for a potential tennis partnership with Lincoln University and the public school system, and some private fundraising efforts that are underway to construct an 8-court tennis complex down in the area of Lafayette and Dunklin Street on Lincoln University property. In addition to that 210, the commission's already reallocated some other current funding, another $90,000 to go along with that. So there's $300,000 in that fund to serve as seed money for that potential partnership project. Also at the top of the page reflects the addition of a new day camp program to be created and operated out at the Greenberry property, designed to accommodate a lot of the waiting list people that we had this year in the program that we were unable to accommodate. And I think there's a detailed sheet, pink sheet, on each of those two items that were attached to your packet also. But the landscape printed sheet kind of gives you a rundown, total impact on revenues, total impact on expense, and it still remains a balanced budget at $7,347,463. So that would need to be incorporated somehow into the budget that you all are looking at now. Those that additional $243,038 are not included in your big budget booklet.
Bill, is there anything that we need to do on that, act on it, or is that just going to be done at the very end when we approve the budget?
It would be helpful if you just have a motion and vote just to add that, make those changes to the budget, kind of like the parking lot. This would be the Parks' version of the parking lot.
Okay.
And then we would make those changes if the budget was approved as is.
All right. Mr. Lockwood, is there any other comments that you would like us to have before we would entertain a motion?
I don't think so.
Councilman Scribner?
Yes. Correct. It would be a subsidized program, as all of our other day camp programs are. The subsidy probably would be a little heavier the first year, since it's be required to purchase some additional supplies and materials since it's a brand new camp. But that would likely drop to some extent in subsequent years.
So your $11,000 would come out of your fund balance, I guess, or?
Correct.
Okay. All right.
Thank you. Any other questions? Councilman Gonzalez?
Yes, thank you. Mr. Lockwood, for several years now, I've harped on the golf course and the ice arena, losing lots of money, and the admin chargeback being at 5%, and according to a sheet that finance put together to start with, if you were paying the same rate as the other enterprise funds on administrative chargeback, it'd be about $428,000, $427,500, instead of $251,000 and change. If we were to take about half that and increase that by about $87,000, while the golf course and ice arena are projected to lose over $500,000 this year, how difficult would it be to make up that money? And the golf courses in Columbia recoup about 90%, and here we're recouping around 60 to 65% of the money that's been in there.
The likelihood of making up or closing the gap on the golf course is not terribly likely. It's kind of comparing apples to oranges. You can't compare any two golf courses. We have much severe terrain. We have a different population base and demographics. They've got a much larger base of customers to draw on, and probably Certainly no more competition than we have, than we face here in Jefferson City with surrounding courses. Typically and historically, all of those facilities have been subsidized. They wouldn't be here. They wouldn't be in operation if they had not been subsidized. And that's part of our mission. Our role is to provide those services. I don't think there's ever been an expectation that they would break even or pay for themselves. We try to make business-like and intelligent decisions to get as close to those cost recovery figures as possible. But we are a governmental service and not a private enterprise or even a true enterprise fund.
I just I look around and we're looking at a tight budget and we need money for maintenance and equipment repair, replacement, just like you guys do. We have streets falling apart, bridges falling apart on us, and the last book you guys handed out at the end of last year, for 2 years ago, it looked like each round of golf out there was subsidized almost $10 a round from a tax money. So it looked like some of that could be made up just in an increase in there, in the what's being charged to the players.
And I think we're fairly aggressive at looking at all of our fees and charges every year. It's a combination of looking at the cost recovery factors, as you mentioned, but also in what the surrounding market is charging in our immediate area, and trying to keep things affordable. We don't really feel like we accomplish a lot if we raise fees and drive more people away from the course, and net income or net bottom line could actually be worse with increased fees. Typically, we do see a short downturn every time we increase fees at the golf course, or most times, not always. So that's always a concern of the commission. We try to discuss those things in our committee structure each year and evaluate, whether we think any fee adjustments are in order. I think we're pretty good about doing incremental changes and not waiting a long period of time to hit people with a large increase. But Marty may be able to speak to that issue as well. We've had a lot of discussions about that, and continue to have on all of our fees and charges each year.
Yeah, I can briefly if you'd like. I mean, it has been my experience that in my time on the commission, we've really tried to get into a little bit more of a groove of more regular increases in some of the charges, and not trying to raise things real rapidly. But trying to be more consistent in how we do that, so that it's not a big shock to anybody, but do that slowly over time. So, I have seen that in action, and it's always a trick to figure out what that right mix is. These, as with most of our operations, or almost all of them, I would say, are designed to be not fully self-sufficient, and that's part of the reason for the way we're set up with the sales tax, is to help make sure that we have those opportunities that are available to folks at a reasonable price. But so,
Councilman Hussey, did you have a
question? Mr. Miller stole a little bit of what I was going to say there. I was going to ask Bill, just for the record, what is the sales tax rate that gets dedicated to parks? Is it a half cent?
Yes, it is a 1/2 cent, and that replaced, I believe, was about a 14 cent property tax levy when it was approved.
I mean, in our golf course is not permitted to sell alcohol, correct?
That's correct.
And so some of these other courses, oftentimes my guess would be that they make up some of their revenue for hosting events or the sale of that through their food and beverage, not just through greens fees, would be my guess for golf. I guess, I understand the need to have rates that help make the books work, but at the same time, my understanding, even when I talk to constituents, it's just, that sales tax that's dedicated to parks, there's an assumption out there to provide quality services, quality facilities, and my guess is that part of that thinking is that, that it helps offset the cost to operate some of these facilities. Without a golf course, without an ice arena, you know, there is a loss to maybe some of the events and opportunities that take place. You know, the golf course is home to the state cross-country meet still, correct?
Yes.
An event that draws significant revenue through the lodging tax to this community. The ice arena is home to the University of Missouri hockey team, ice shows, and things that draw people here. And so while I think what I would advocate for, and I think the commission does a good job, is to make sure that those rates are set in a competitive way with an eye towards, you know, making sure that we're not over-subsidizing some of these activities, while at the same time, I guess my philosophy is that that sales tax, the design would be to help offset some of those expenses as well, and make these activities affordable to our citizens. So that's kind of my stance. I think I have faith in the commission to make sure that those things are taken care of and make sure that these programs and activities get closer to balancing out, but an understanding that, that there is a sales tax dedicated to assist that as well.
Councilman Scribner?
I agree certainly with the spirit of what you said, even if I might not agree with every word that you said. But I do think we have to be diligent, and because there is a sales tax component to their funding, I do think we have to be careful that we don't also fund from general revenue funds excessively. You have to be careful that there aren't hidden subsidies that the taxpayer's not aware of, or even maybe some of us on the council aren't aware of. That's why I'm glad to see that the mayor did raise the rent on the annex, or did approve that, and will ultimately, I guess, approve or disapprove that. But I think that's a step in the right direction, because otherwise it is a subsidy from general fund, general revenue, and taxpayers, I think, when they voted for the sales tax, were saying we want to establish a funding source, and then the parks and rec should be funded out of that funding source, not out of general revenue any longer. And at least that's the way I interpreted that. So I do think we have to be diligent in making sure that we are aware whenever there's monies going from general revenue to any program. Bill, I had a question for you. I was looking down through here, and I wondered if maybe you could give us some insight as to why there were 22,350 rounds of golf played in 2014. It looks like the goal for 2015 was set lower than that, and then it's set lower again in 2016. Same way with tournament rounds. It looks like it was 2,195 in 2014, and there's a reduction to 1950 in 2015 and 2000 in 2016. Lesson participants, there's actually a goal. I mean, it was actual was 1434, and it's 1,000 for 2015 and 1,200 for 2016. And that just seems intuitively, that doesn't seem like we'd want to be heading in a direction of fewer participants rather than more.
I think this performance measurement information that you see there, this is the first year we've actually kind of put that information together. I think the 2014 actual column does reflect last year, but in putting together this year's budget and trying to project ahead is what our goals are. We're so weather dependent. You know, I think we're going to come up short this year because we had such a lousy year weather-wise, and our rounds are down quite a bit from what they were. Our revenue certainly down compared to last year at the same time. So, I mean, hopefully those trends would continue to go up, but We tended to be pretty conservative in our approach to estimating those things, and hopefully we're gonna work to do better than those. Once we get a better trend line for a year or two on these, I think we'll be able to settle in and maybe look at these more long-term basis. Right now, it's kind of a short window to look at projections and see where we stand. It is up and down quite a bit based on weather alone.
And then I would also maybe you could give us some insight on the number of full-time positions. It appears that you're anticipating an increase of 2.5 full-time positions in 2016.
No, I don't think so. That's a mistake. We're still budgeting same number of staff out there this year. I mean, next year's there's nothing in the pink sheets for additional positions out there. I missed that one. Sorry.
Okay. Thank you.
Do we have any other questions for Mr. Lockwood or Mr. Miller? Councilman Graham?
Mr. Lockwood, going back to what Councilman Hussey and what Councilman Costales had originally brought up, and you may not know this, but what are the green fees for our golf course? Do you know? And I guess along those same lines, when was the last time it was increased? When were those fees the last time it was increased?
Let's see. The golf is on. Yeah, if you look at the program guide, this particular one on page 8 lists what those are. And I'm sorry, but I didn't catch the second half of your question there.
I said, when was the last time those fees were actually increased?
I'd have to go back and look. We try to typically rotate increasing greens fees versus cart fees so that they're not both going up on the same year. I believe we did make some adjustments to annual pass numbers earlier prior to this season.
Okay. Because I know they was talking about the loss of revenue, and I was just thinking if there's like maybe a room for some type of increase, a small increase, but I guess something is better than nothing. So just my thoughts.
Right. Well, we are definitely an overbuilt golf market in the area. So, I mean, we're suffering from a lot of competition out there. And it's our experience that the Jefferson City golfing public is follows pricing pretty closely and goes where it's most economical, so that's been a challenge for us to reach that optimum level.
Thank you,
Councilman Mihalovich.
Help me out with a little history. What year did we acquire that and create a golf course?
The property was actually, the first 50 acres of the property were donated to the city in 1917. It became a golf course shortly thereafter. I think I recently saw some research where the first tournament was held, I believe in 1917 or 1980. It was a fundraiser for the Red Cross, which was being created at the same time. The property was added to with three major additions over the years. The latest one of those being the 28 acres behind fire station number 4 that occurred probably about 10 years ago. There were two other parcels of about 50 acres each added over time. The last one of those being about 1963 or so, and that's at the point the lake was built to serve as an irrigation supply for the course. It was also operated as a private club for a number of years by the Huff Park Golf Association. It was given back to the city, I think it probably in the early to mid-60s, when that group of golfers went out and formed the Meadow Lake Acres Country Club and built the course in New Bloomfield, and it came back as a city-operated course at that time.
And I'm going to guess that there's very few other courses at the time that was established.
I think the country club is about the same age, but the others in the immediate area are quite a bit newer than that.
Councilman Hussey.
I guess I would make a motion to amend the budget to reflect the items submitted by Mr. Lockwood.
It's been moved and seconded to accept the amendments for the Parks and Recs budget. Discussion. Councilman Scribner?
Just a quick question. How will that affect?
It won't. We'll keep this as its own separate parks fund, having its own separate parking lot there. So.
Okay.
Councilman Pussy?
I would just add, it's a big change, but that tennis partnership, there's a lot of players involved, and I think that's a real unique opportunity to leverage a little bit of parks fund with some other funding sources and do something very exciting in that Lafayette Street corridor. So thank you for being a part of that.
I think Lincoln University has already committed $300,000 to that as
that's
well,
correct.
And I think there's a meeting later this week or next week with the school district to talk about their participation and some private fundraising efforts. I'm not sure quite where they stand at the moment, but certainly some strong interest there.
And if I could just real briefly to tack on to that, since Councilman Hussey mentioned, I do want to reiterate that appreciation from the commission for the council's support on a number of these things. Whether it's a possible tennis partnership or our project with Lincoln, there's really a lot of exciting things happening for the Parks Department right now, and those things are only possible because of the funding sources that we have and the support that we have and from the council and from the community. So we're really pretty excited about a lot of those opportunities kind of on the horizon and how they can make Jefferson City a better place to live, work, and play. So.
Okay, is there any other questions or comments on the motion? Seeing none, we will take roll call, please.
Branch?
Aye.
Costales?
Aye.
Graham?
Aye.
Henry?
Aye.
Hussey?
Aye.
Mihaljevic?
Aye.
Prather?
Aye.
Scrivener?
Aye.
Ward?
Aye.
All right, motion passes. Is there any other questions or comments or motions that we'd like to make on the Parks and Recs section? Councilman Costales?
I'd like to move that we increase the administrative chargeback by $87,934, which is half of the shortfall.
Okay, we have a motion on the floor. Is there a second? Seeing none, that motion dies. Is there any other motions to be made? All right. Looks like we're done for the day with Parks and Recs. Mr. Lockwood, Mr. Miller, thank you for coming today.
Thank you all very much.
All right, this time we are going to move into wastewater, and Mr. Marash is going to lead the way.
Certainly. Eric Seaman here with me today as well.
Great. And we'll probably do this one similar to what we've done before. Matt's going to go over some of the changes, some of the highlights, and then as he goes through, if you guys want to comment or wait till the very end, you guys are welcome to.
All
Ready to start? Go for it. Okay. Matt Marash, Public Works Director, Eric Seaman, the Wastewater Division Director. And so just real quickly, the Wastewater Division of Public Works has 35 employees, has an operating budget roughly of $11 million in round numbers, brings in, our fund currently brings in around $11.6 million. That's a very conservative estimate of what the revenue brings in. We have three, Public Works has 10 divisional budgets, but this wastewater comprises three of those budgets, and it's wastewater admin, wastewater plant and pump stations, and then wastewater collections. Basically, just real quick, the primary focus of wastewater is our day-to-day operations. The systems can't fail or it becomes a regulatory issue, so we're always constantly very vigilant in maintaining our system, cleaning it, keeping up with its maintenance, and then also our regulatory compliance. Both kind of go hand in hand. Another focus that we've been looking at in the last year or so, and you all well know it, is our EPA consent order and getting some major projects under construction. And we've just got a couple of those on the council agenda recently, and there's some more in the bond request in this budget. I would say just real quick, just kind of give a kind of a basically, you know, our wastewater staff, we've got a great wastewater staff, very knowledgeable. They keep our system at a high level of compliance, and I think part of that is being proactive in our maintenance and our in construction program. But keeping up with that equipment, you know, it's not it's basically a readiness type issue, just like any other equipment we have. We get a new flusher because we need it to work. It needs to be clean. You know, we need to clean regulatory. We need to be keeping up with cleaning of the lines, but also that results in better compliance in the future, so you have less overflows and backups and things like that. So all these things go hand in hand. And I think the result, you know, the way we demonstrate that is the result, we've been doing a good job, is when we did get into EPA inspection, our compliance basically was just kind of accelerating a few of the projects that are already in the planned loop and the bond program that we had. The city didn't have to go back to the voters, get a different bond approved or anything like that. It was already there. Our rate structure was in place to handle those issues. So I think the wastewater staff, not me, the people way before me, were doing a lot of good thinking and keeping the city in good compliance. And I think the result is the citizens in Jefferson City have a very reasonable wastewater fee, so that's a really good thing. Just quickly, the budget's very much the same as it has been in past years. Again, already touched on the fees generate about $11.6 million a year right now. There are two fee increases built in wastewater in 16 and 17. They'll both be another fee increase, and that was approved with the bond issue, so that rate structure is in place. And then within that 11.6, about 645 is being transferred to the fund balance. And just today, even Sheila and I were calculating and making sure we understood the fund balance. And it's a little bit tricky to sometimes calculate the wastewater fund balance because we're going in off audited numbers from 14. So we're already through 15, and we're making purchases and doing things. And then, of course, you know, we're doing a 16 budget. So when we put this together, we actually had pink sheets for about $1 million of capital out of fund balance. Well, we found out once the audit came in and started looking at the numbers more closely is that that equates to about what our cash fund balance is, about the same. So those weren't funded in the budget, that $970,000 roughly of cash projects, and that's probably a good thing to keep our fund balance where it is. We also have a $2 million reserve fund balance, so about, I would call it in rough numbers, about $3 million of set aside money in a $10-11 million budget. So I think there are, you know, again, it speaks to the management in the past is that it's got good cash flow and is working well. So basically within the only thing that wasn't included in the budget, I'm not sure, I can't recall Bill or Sheila, on the $10 million, we had it as a pink sheet, it wasn't approved, but that, I'm not sure exactly why, but that directly ties to our EPA consent order. The first two projects are right in the order and need to be started so they can be completed on time. It would be the last drawdown in the total $35 million bond project. So we've already drawn down $25 million of the bonds approved by the voters, and this would be the last 10 to get those projects started. The other three projects, I believe, is on there is basically they were compliance issues as well. And again, kind of keeping up with those compliance issues so we don't run into problems later, get those started and keep those moving. So all compliance related things with the bonds. And so I is that a something that needs to go in the parking lot, or how, what's the process here, Bill, for that?
Yeah, and I'll say that that's probably my fault whenever it came to that pink sheet not being approved. So we told Mr. Kroll not to approve any of them because of what Matt had discussed with their fund balance issue, but not meaning for them not to approve the bonding piece there. So so if the council's okay with the bonding piece moving forward, more discussion on that, then it certainly needs to be a motion and it put on. It wouldn't be on this parking lot again. It would be wastewater's own parking lot we would create for them. So
you're looking for a motion to approve 10,000 or 10 million?
The 10 million for the bond. Yeah.
So moved. Second.
All right, so moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Ms. Marashi, do you have anything else to comment on that?
No.
Pretty much said it all.
Tried to cover it.
Mr. Mihaljevic?
What are...
Yeah, let's see here. The next 10 million, if you look, there's a pink sheet that says it's on page 334 in the book. It says wastewater bond projects, and there are six of them listed. And when the sixth one's the loan closing cost, so really five. But replace Hazleton Pump Station, something we've been talking about in various committee meetings for a while, but this would actually go ahead and get it funded and going. And then Basin 13 upgrade Valley View Interceptor Sewer, another $1 million. And if you want a lot of detail, obviously I got Eric here and we can probably tell you more about it than you'd really like to know. East Branch Wears Creek upgrade, which is basically the main line right here behind City Hall. It would kind of tie on to where we left off over here at the Lafayette Interchange and get it on down to the pump station here at Walnut. Green Meadows Pump Station in Force Main, that goes from Morrow School, I'll call it Ellis Boulevard area, back to the Green Meadows Pump Station and old Force Main, and some upgrades to that pump station. And then we have three Force Mains on number five, within that number five one there, and I can't remember the three names of them, but basically they're old Force Mains that need to be looked at so we avoid future compliance issues and get those projects moving along. So do you remember the three names of them right off the top?
Yeah, it's the Riverside Force Main that goes through the park and along the Missouri River, the Westview Force Main that comes up along Scruggs Road and goes into County Park, and then the third one is the Highway 54 Force Main, and that crosses at Route C, by St. Mary's. It'll be to the south of St. Mary's.
All right, is there any other questions or comments? Councilman Scribner?
How much longer will we be before these bonds are retired? I see that 50% of the, I believe I saw a graph here where 50% of the expense is debt service.
The first big chunk comes from the $52 million bond issues, so there'll be the biggest piece of that will be retired in 2022. So
and that's 52 million?
That's approximately 22 million. Is it we actually took pieces out of that too. We didn't do one loan closing on the 52 million.
Okay. But that'll be retired. And that represents what percentage would you say of our outstanding debt?
I'm going to somewhat defer to these guys. I mean, it's kind of a complicated question because there's some different loan closings and I think some refinancings, things like that. So it's not just a straight.
I guess I was just wondering how I think we're almost up against our ability, our capacity to bond at this point, aren't we?
If this 10 million will be the last 10 million we're authorized
until we've retired some debt.
Well, I mean,
you said capacity.
Well, that's what I mean. As you
voter approved, but financial capacity might be another question.
That's what I was talking
about. And even if you retire those bonds, we'd still have to go back and get a new voter approval. So, let's say that the ones Eric's referring to that will retire in 2022, will still go We still have to go back for voter approval before we can do any further bonds.
I guess in my mind, there are two terms. There's authorized, which voters have authorized, and there's capacity, which means that you have the financial wherewithal to do additional bonding if you had to.
Well, I would say, you know, like when there was a model developed and a rate increase accepted to do this $35 million. Now, most of this is, or almost all of it, I guess, is regulatory driven. And so we don't know what the future regulations are. We know there's a bunch of them being in the works. Now, when they come implementation time and all of that, but hopefully we get a little reprieve for a while after we get this bond done. But certainly there'll be new regulatory things. Now, it just by bonding, you get to mean that out over time and not have big increases, but right. You know, you can't guarantee that.
Well, I guess what I was thinking was that most all this work that we're doing is refurbishing and so we're really kind of working from behind. We're going in and taking established and upgrading. And I was just wondering if there was are we going to get to a point at some point where we are proactively improving and increasing and enhancing our system as opposed to going in and refurbishing, or will we always just be in a mode of refurbishing?
I think generally you are in a refurbishing mode because your ratepayers, you know, that gets to a philosophical question. If you start expanding the system on the ratepayers' dime, is that the proper thing to do? I guess the council could do it. When we have that discussion occasionally, if some developer comes in, should we pay that out from the ratepayers' fee? They're paying the fees to maintain their system and keep their wastewater compliant and treated. So,
okay, I have a couple other questions here. On your page 313, it shows that you're expecting to go from 2.15 billion gallons of wastewater treated up to 2.19. But when it goes to sludge being applied to the land, I guess it actually does increase. I was thinking that it had decreased. But the gallons of wastewater except in waste haulers is decreasing. Are we just doing less of that, or why would we accept less?
We're just trying to value this as being conservative. It's
okay.
It's based on, you know, their demand, more or less.
Okay, and I noticed that I have to go back and find it now. Change pages. There's your sewer connection fees. In 2015, we budgeted $39,000, which was just slightly less than actual for 2013, and a little bit less than actual for 2014. But we're only budgeting $23,000 this year. Are we just anticipating, I guess, maybe because there's not going to be a new St. Mary's or something like that? Or
I think, like I said, I think our revenue is very conservative estimate, which is in our favor because typically we always exceed it. If you even look back at 13 and 14, the revenue we actually received is actually fairly high considering we get a 5% increase. So. And I think, you know, construction is down a little bit, so we're just trying to keep very conservative in these estimates. So we'll likely exceed them, I would hope, but we don't budget for that.
Okay. That's all I have.
Okay, is there any other questions on the motion? And let me see here. Is there a motion? Go ahead, what the motion is. Okay. Let's move in the second. Now we're ready for roll call.
Branch?
Aye.
Costales?
Aye.
Graham?
Aye.
Henry?
Aye.
Hussey?
Aye.
Mihalovich?
Aye.
Prather?
Aye.
Scrivener?
Aye.
Ward?
Aye.
All right. Thank you. It passes. Mr. Betts, do we need to pass their budget as a whole, or is that just going to be included?
Nope, that'll be at the end whenever you're ready to move the whole budget on to the council.
All right, thank you. Councilman Graham?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. I have a question. As relates to if the EPA comes in and they find something that's not right for some reason, and there's a fine that's assessed, is that paid through the fund balance through wastewater, or how does that go?
Well, I mean, we'd have to determine at the time if we had enough money in the budget, or we'd have to come back to a supplemental. I think the answer is yes. But somewhere through the wastewater, is that what you meant? Somewhere through the wastewater fund, now that we had in the budget, had to supplement it out of the budget. The answer would be yes.
Thank you.
All right, is there any questions? Councilman Scribner.
I guess that was the reason for my question earlier about the capacity, so that if for some reason, you know, we just use the last of our $10 million, and if EPA or somebody like that came in and said, you have to do this upgrade, and you have to do it now, and it's going to cost $25 million, is the capacity within our system to bond another $25 million if the voters would vote for it? I don't think there is. I think we're almost up against our total bonding, aren't we, or do we have
right? You'd have to go back and study the rates to determine the level of additional capacity you might have there. Likely, you would have to do some incremental increases in the future. But again, you look at our rates in Jefferson City; they're pretty good rates compared to others around us. Especially when they have compliance issues, they usually have to go fairly high. We've been fortunate by being very proactive, I think, in our wastewater side like this.
I guess I did have another question. The number of sanitary sewer overflows, I was a little surprised and disappointed here to see that we're actually projecting more overflows in 15 and 16 than we had in 14. I thought that a lot of this work we were doing was going to eliminate overflows.
Well, I think Bill mentioned it before. These kind of are new performance measures. Per mile of sewer, there's an expected overflow number. And so our hope is it's much less than the goal. Hopefully it's zero, but it probably won't be. And so you're allowed so many per mile. This is just kind of a look at wastewater, I guess. It's not necessarily meant to be, my mind, a tool for what you were saying, I think.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions on wastewater? Mr. Marash, do you have anything else?
No.
All right. Well, thank both of you, Mr. Marash and Mr. Seaman. Thank you for coming. And at this time, Bill, do we want to move into any other sections? If so,
yes,
you can take the lead.
All right, I will do it. We'd like to kind of go over the small funds that are in the budget. So if you got your budget books there in front of you, we'll start with the green tab. Well, not the green tab. That's parks. No, I misspoke. The yellow tab, sorry. The workers' comp. We're going to go through some of the smaller funds here real quick. What's that?
That was close.
Tab number four, the yellow tab there. So most of these are just small funds that we have on the side that there's not a whole lot different from the year before. But just wanted to go through these because when you approve the budget, you are approving these as well. So this first one here is the workers' comp fund. The city is self-insured for its workers' comp. Last year, we only asked the enterprise funds to contribute to workers' comp. But this year, in order to keep our balance where it needs to be, we needed to have the general fund also contribute. So all funds are contributing this year. So if you're looking in your budget book there, you'll see that there's $200,000 worth of revenue approved in the mayor's budget. Versus last year where it was $44,322. So then you can see as far as revenues are concerned, there's some interest that goes into that. And then we also budget to take money from the surplus. So and this is one of those funds where we don't try to contribute too much because we don't want the fund balance. I mean, the fund balance is somewhere typically in the neighborhood of $900,000 to $1 million. But since we're self-insured, we want to keep it at a pretty good level. But at the same time, we don't want to let it get to 1.5 because we're just contributing for no reason. So you can kind of see all the expenses that go along those lines. Some of them are hard to, kind of quantify. So we hope that Like, for instance, provisions for unsettled claims. Obviously, we'd like that number to be zero every year, but it's not. So we do budget money for that as part of it. And this is one of those funds where any money that's not spent as the expenses will always go back into its fund balance to keep the number up there. So to hopefully reduce the contribution rate from the other funds in the general fund as well. So happy to answer any questions you might have.
Councilman Henry.
Bill, I think I missed something there. Could you explain that difference between that $44,000 from last year and the $200,000?
Sure. Yep. Last year, the fund was at a level that we didn't need as much of a contribution. So it was probably closer to the $1 million mark, which is kind of typically our goal for the fund balance. So what we did was we just asked the enterprise funds to contribute to that versus having the general fund contribute. This year, the number got down low enough to where it was felt that we needed to have all the funds contribute. So obviously the contribution rate went up, and the general fund's contributing a larger amount there.
Okay, any other questions for Mr. Betts? Councilman Scribner.
Mr. Mihaljevic just asked me, and so I'm going to ask you, why do we do that every year? Or why don't we do it every year?
Help me understand. I'm not sure.
Why don't we do that every year is have these enterprise funds putting in?
Oh, they do put in every year. It's just last year it was decided to have them contribute and not have the general fund contribute as part of the budget. So they do contribute every year, and they're contributing this year as well as part of the $200,000.
So my question is going to be, you mentioned a fund balance for this particular.
Yes.
Is that accounted for separately from our other reserve fund balance?
It is, yes.
And how much is the fund balance?
The exact number I don't know right off the top of my head, but it's somewhere in the neighborhood of $1 million.
So it's not on this sheet anywhere, because I couldn't find $1 million on here anywhere.
At least
in this section.
No, it wouldn't be here on this section. That's correct.
Okay. And so it's accounted for where?
Well, it's its own fund, and we account for it. It wouldn't be here. None of the fund balances show up in the budget document. So it has its own. Every fund has their own fund balance. So the general fund has a fund balance, wastewater, parking, parks, and similarly here, this fund has its. And all the funds that we're going to talk about have some level of a fund balance of their own.
Okay.
This is just one that we have to maintain at a very high level because it's a self-insurance type thing.
And you never know when you're going to need it.
Correct.
Any other questions on the workers' compensation section? No, seeing none, we'll move on to the next one.
Yep. If you want to go to the blue tab now, tab number 6 there. Under tab 6, the first tab you have there is the Veterans Plaza. The Veterans Plaza is up here on the corner out front of the police department. We didn't budget for any revenue, so like the sell of bricks or anything. We typically have maybe a couple a year, but we didn't budget for that. We do have roughly $2,000 worth of interest that comes into this account, and then there's some maintenance that goes into that particular area. So the revenue and the expense offset each other for this. And it's pretty well a self-sustaining fund. There's enough interest typically every year to take care of the maintenance. The fund balance creates enough of an interest there for this particular area.
Councilman Graham?
How much are those bricks, and are there any more availability?
I'm fairly sure there's some more availability.
Yeah, there's a lot of availability, actually. I mean, we've designed that. I think there's bricks on the ground. They're in the boxes as well, and I can't recall the cost. It's Britt, do you recall?
I have numbers in my head, but I'm afraid it's wrong, so I'm afraid to say it.
Me too.
If you could just maybe email me the cost for those so I can.
We'll get it. Get an answer to you.
Okay.
I believe, I'm like Britt, I'll say a number, but it may be wrong, but I believe it's $100 a brick. So.
Okay. Is there any other questions in this area? Seems pretty straightforward. So,
Yeah, like most of these will be, I think, for the most
part. You're welcome to move on.
All right, the next one here is the police training fund. This is the $3 fund that the chief spoke about when he was doing his presentation. In the years past, we've taken quite a bit. When you get down to the expense area there, you'll see that we budgeted quite a bit more over the last couple of years because this was one of those funds that had a pretty substantial fund balance. We've drawn that fund balance down now to a point where we can't take the $62,000 that we had last year out of there. So the general fund has to go back to paying for some of the police training as well to help that. So the revenues are what you see there, and then the expenses, part of the budget, the police asked for $62,000 for training. 12 of it will come from here. The other 50 comes from the general fund.
Any questions? Mr. Scribner.
So does that average for the $3? Does the $3 average about $12,000 a year? Is that what I think I heard you say?
I think we kind of estimate that it'll bring in about $10,000 a year. Then they get a little bit of interest. Their interest is down quite a bit from what it had been in years past because they used to have a much larger fund balance there. But it brings in $800 in interest is what we're kind of budgeting for, and then we'll take a little bit out of their fund reserve. They still have a little bit of a fund reserve to help make that $12,000 number.
So now that that fund has been essentially depleted,
correct,
we can look forward to about $50,000 or so a year coming out of general revenue going forward.
Right, and it
if we maintain the training at the same level.
That's correct, and I think that it, in fairness, and it doesn't show up here, that prior to 2013, there was a substantial amount of money that came out of the general fund all along for the police training. It was just in order to help balance the budgets over the tougher times there, we use this fund a little bit more regularly.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
All right. Any other questions? Seeing none, we'll move on to the next tab.
Okay.
Or topic.
The next item is the lodging tax revenues. As the council's aware, when the CVB does their budget, the council has to approve that budget every year, and the reason is because the money comes through the city for lodging tax. We have a 7 cents lodging tax. 3 cents of that goes towards the CVB's budget, and you'll kind of you can see that here in your expense where it says transfer to Convention and Visitors Bureau. We estimate that to be about $462,000. The other 4 cents goes towards the lockbox that the city maintains. We estimate that to be at about $616,000 for next year. And then the general fund gets 2% off of the top of all of that for administrative fees. So there, I think it's about $23,800 is what we estimate for the general fund. The general fund gets 2% off the top, and then any interest that's accrued here goes to the general fund. So,
any questions on the lodging tax fund? Mayor Turgeon?
Thank you. I also wanted to add, while we're talking about the lodging tax, at a previous meeting when the Convention and Visitors Bureau agreed to match a potential $15,000 budget item for MSP, to clarify that it's not coming out of the lodging tax, I'll read a quick email from Diane Gillespie, the director. She says, as a follow-up to the $15,000 for the MSP project that you have proposed for the 2016 city budget, as you have indicated, this would be a matching program between the city and the CVB. I would like to clarify that the CVB portion would be from the MSP funds and not from the lodging tax. And please, lodging tax revenue, please let her know if there's any questions. So none of it is coming out of this. And I'll forward this to the council and Phyllis for the record just so they have it. So just wanted to clarify, none of it is coming out of lodging tax funds.
All right,
it's MSP revenue. Thank you.
Okay, any other questions? Councilman Mihaljevic?
How much is in that lockbox right now? Is that from our last finance committee? Is that
what it is?
So is that, I think it's about $5.5 million or $4.5 million?
We're pulling it up. Give us 1 second. We'll make sure. We're having technical difficulties. We'll get you that answer. So,
all right. Any other questions?
Don't get back to us on that. Go ahead and move to the next section.
Yep.
If you
want to, or if you want to go into...
Nope, I'm ready. I'll finish.
Whatever you decide.
Oh, here we go. We got it up now. The number is... $2,529,000 is currently in that lockbox.
Okay.
All right. So I'm going to jump to the City Hall Trust. City Hall Trust is a trust. There's some artwork here around City Hall that you've seen, and they set up a trust fund before for any maintaining of that if need be. That trust fund earns interest each year. Typically, we don't budget for any expenses. If there's a significant expense that comes up, we'll bring that to the council and ask for a supplemental appropriation from the fund balance. So pretty straightforward fund at this point in time. The next one there is the fire pension fund. It's even easier. That is a closed fund, so we don't take in any revenue and expenses. That kind of is self-maintained at the current time. And as far as the funding is concerned, it's doing well enough that the general fund or nobody has to do any supplements for that. So it's maintaining itself and all of its expenses. So the next one is the USS Jeff City Submarine Trust. For this budget year, the only thing we calculated in was interest income for its fund balance. There's been no request at this time for any of the crew that's serving on the submarine to come to Jefferson City. If that were to change, again, we would come back to the council and let you know we need to do a supplemental appropriation, and we would take money from their fund balance to cover that. Woodland Cemetery. The Woodland Cemetery, there's a couple of things we have. We do get some interest income here, and we've also going to transfer some money out of the surplus, and this is basically for maintenance in the Woodland Cemetery. At the current time, it can maintain its own self for the maintenance that occurs there. At some point in time, the general fund may have to cover that, but at today's way it's set up today, is there's enough money in the fund balance and enough money from interest to cover any of the maintenance that might occur there. And we do set aside $5,000 for Janice McMillan's group to maintain any maintenance type things that need to happen there. And then the last one is the TIF fund. Within the TIF fund, you will see that there are a number. We have three TIFs actually right now that are active. You have O'Donohue's TIF, you have the Southside TIF, and you have the Mall TIF. The hard part about all of these when we do the budgeting for these is if our numbers are wrong, we hope they're wrong to the good side, to the plus side, because that means that those are doing better and they're bringing in, generating more revenue than was expected. So we put together a balanced budget based on the best numbers that we have today. We hope that those numbers increase and do better. But the way it's set up today is for O'Donohue's for $3,200, the South Side for $18,000, and the Mall for $12,000. And basically they have a baseline. If you just to remind the council how that works, is there's a baseline for every TIF, and then any amount of sales tax that's brought in above that baseline for when this TIF was established is split between the city and the business owner 50-50 at that time. So
any questions on this section, Councilman Scrivener?
Just a clarification, anything that's below the baseline still goes 100% to the taxing authority.
Yeah, that's correct. Anything, so if it's below, so let's say they do less than they had hoped they were going to do, then the city would not pay out anything at that time. So the city only pays out if they go above the baseline. That's a correct statement. And Mr. Hilpert might want to add something to that, I think.
Not really. Actually, I was just going to say it's actually a tremendous amount of work. And so, Sheila, I just want to give her a little props here. Does a really good job with that. At some point, if we keep doing a lot of TIFs, it's almost a full-time gig, but especially with the South Side, as we were untangling that, and Sheila's just doing a lot of work. So I just want to say, hey, good job, Sheila.
Councilman Scribner?
O'Donohue's has been in place for a while now. Do you know how much time is left on that TIF?
I think we can look, just if you want to give us 1 second here.
As she's looking, I'm pretty sure they're going to pay off early, but...
And I guess while you're looking, the TIF on the South Side, it hasn't been adjusted for very long, but have we been seeing the desired changes based on the adjustment to that TIF?
I don't know that we can answer that now. I think the adjustment has helped, but I don't think we've had enough time since the adjustment to...
That couldn't have been more than a month or two.
Right, yeah, to know if that's...
When we got it all entangled and we had to sit down with them to make sure our numbers matched with theirs, they felt pretty confident going forward that it was going to be okay and work out for everybody.
Okay, thank you.
We'll answer your question about Adonis. I'll just send it out in email to the council.
That sounds right. Thank you. Is there any other questions in this section? Mr. Best, I think if I'm correct, we have two sections left.
That's a correct statement.
And that's Public Works and Planning Protective Services?
Correct. And there's one other item that we'll discuss, that we typically discuss at some point, and not tonight, is the sales tax F. Each year we have an allocation. The council approves the allocation, and you'll see in your budget books here, if I can find the right tab, under tab 3 there, you'll see sales tax tabs, and there is one for sales tax F. I will be sending out the we typically send out a spreadsheet that kind of shows the breakdown over the 5 years, the five-year plan, so it shows what's happened thus far and shows what we're planning, how the breakdown's planned for 2016, and then there's also a half a year in 2017. So I will send that out to the council as well so that we can discuss that at the next meeting if that would be fine with the council. Okay. And I can answer the O'Donohue's question real quick.
Sure, go right
ahead. The O'Donohue's question is it looks like it would go through 2027, but it's anticipated right now to be done within 2020. So they could go through 2027, but they're ahead of schedule well enough that we anticipate it being over in 2020 if they continue at their current pace.
Thank you.
Councilman Scriven, did you hear that?
Oh, that's okay. Sorry. We got the TIF information on O'Donohue's. It could go out to 2027. The agreement was to go out to 2027, but right now they're on pace to retire that in 2020. So they're doing pretty good.
You know, that's great news.
Yep.
When they retire early, that means that number one, they're doing good. Business wise.
Yeah, it's doing what it was intended to do. I would agree. Mm-hmm.
Great. Well, I guess this time we will move on to the next topic.
Sure, yes.
And would that be the gross utility tax?
That's correct. At the last meeting, I spoke, handed out a little handout to the council. I hope you had them because I didn't bring other ones back with me. So, but there was a handout about the gross receipts utility tax. And the just given council, we've been asked a question from the council about what it would generate. So we gave some different options there. We gave a 6%, a 6.5%, and a 7%. Just to give a little background history, I'll do this again on Monday night, but each year there is a public hearing on the gross receipts utility tax. Our ordinance requires that. But in sometime in the 1960s, we can't figure out exactly when, but it was set at 7% for telephone, for gas, and electric. It was set at 7%. In 1980, the Hancock Amendment came along, and the Hancock Amendment, and I'm not going to pretend to be a lawyer here, but talking to the lawyer and understanding his writing, the Hancock Amendment basically says whatever the tax rate is set at that time is the authorized amount. So our tax rate was still set at 7% for all three of those categories. In 1982, the council reduced the electric and gas down to 6.55%. And then in 1984, they reduced it again down to the current level of 5.65%. So for electric and gas, we're currently sitting at 5.65%, and for telephone, we're sitting at 7%. But answering the questions that the council asked for us as to what kind of revenue does this generate, we've came up with some rough estimates of what it would do. We also gave you a sheet of what the average utility cost would be based on that. My request of the council at the last meeting was if there's a move afoot to, or if you feel strongly that you might want to consider raising this, I think it would be prudent upon us to make sure that the citizens know, because rarely does anyone come to the gross receipts utility tax public hearing, because it's been 30 some years since it's been changed. So I think it would be prudent to make sure that the public knew if there was a strong consideration. If there's a strong consideration saying we're not interested in changing it, then that might be also worth noting as well.
So basically that's open for discussion?
Correct, yes, okay. Sir.
Councilman Hollovich.
Can you go over those dates and rates again?
Yep, I can do that. You got this 1960s, yeah, I'm not sure. but then in 1982, the rates went down to 6.55%, and in 1984, the rates went down to 5.65%. And again, that's just for gas and electric. Telephone has remained 7% the entire time. And cable doesn't fall under there. On occasion, I misstep and say that. I've been trying to be more careful about that, but cable does not fall under the gross receipts utility tax. It actually falls under a franchise tax. The city used to have a franchise agreement. The state has taken that over, but in taking that over, the state set the amount at 5%, capped the amount at 5%, and that is what the city charges, is 5% as well. Okay. I don't want to say that, yes, that's the average, because we don't know, because we did ask, we did inquire, and we were told they couldn't give us that information at this time. So, but the average increase, if you did 6% for the year, would be $8.40 if you went up to the 6% for the, it would be $10.50 if you considered the average bill to be $250 a month. And that would be gas and electric combined. If they equal $250, the annual increase would be $10.50. So a little less than a dollar a month.
Could be a little less, a little more, depending on the average.
Yeah, depending on where you're, yeah.
And are you looking just as a general discussion tonight, probably not a motion? I would assume that it wouldn't be an appropriate place to have a motion.
Right. I'm not sure. I mean, you could if you all felt strongly, but I think it would be, the motion I'd be looking for, or the direction I'd be looking for, is if council felt strongly that, you know, this is something you're really going to consider, we'd like to put out a press release and do a little bit more public education about this issue before next Monday's public hearing. So that's what I would be looking for, some direction there.
So in other words, if we're thinking about or contemplating having an increase, we ought to bring it up now.
Correct.
Or a motion to leave it as is.
Yeah, if the council says we're not going to consider it at all, then we'll make sure people know that, but we won't make as much of an educational
for that, because that's probably what will happen on Monday anyhow.
Right.
Okay. Councilman Mihalovich?
So do we already have a motion, the public hearing, and it's not something we could put on the informal or anything like that?
No, we've already posted the public hearing, and that is to come, so it's required at that next meeting. So.
Councilman Hussey?
And I'm sorry if you said this.
You could. Sorry.
You can finish.
Yeah, you could. I mean, we could certainly have another public hearing if that was the council's desire afterwards on this topic. So.
I'm sorry if you answered this. Are we restricted on the increments in which this can be increased?
No.
So you've picked 6, 6.5, 7, but it's 5, 6, 5 right now.
Right.
So we could even consider 5.75, 5.8, something like that.
Yep.
Okay.
Whenever the question came to us from the council, we weren't sure, so we just put together some numbers. You could increment at whatever level you felt comfortable with, or not increment at all.
Councilman Scribner.
It's my opinion, and it's my opinion, only opinion here, but we've sat here, I don't know, even in our budget hearing, our budget meetings last year, we were given a model that shows, or shortly after our budget meetings, a model that shows what our revenue projections are and our fund balance projections and our need in terms of capital replacement items. We've looked at a number of pink sheet requests for capital replacement items that are we're not going to be able to fund. We're looking at doing a lease on automobiles for the first time. I know we've leased fire fire trucks, but for the first time, police vehicles. So I don't know how we can responsibly not at least discuss that tax. I'm not saying that our discussions will yield or result in us increasing it, but if we're going to have a public hearing and the public is going to be here to listen to us and to offer their input, I think that the discussion ought to be held, even though it'll be somewhat painful. I can't imagine any of us feel real comfortable talking about increasing taxes. I certainly don't. But I also am a realist, and I do understand that we can't just keep kicking the can down the road in terms of replacing equipment, because someday that we'll have to pay the piper for that, you know, dalliance of not going ahead and taking care of that issue. So I think we need, I know I've talked to some councilmen individually, but I certainly haven't talked to everyone on the council, and I do think everyone on the council should offer some input and consider this over the next few days, and so that we can all be prepared to talk about it Monday night. So I would be in favor of letting the public know that at least that there will be a discussion. I'm not prepared to say we're strongly leaning toward doing it or strongly leaning against doing it, but just notifying the public that we will be discussing the issue.
You know, I'd like to echo Councilman Scribner's thoughts there, and I don't know if we have to come to a figure tonight, but as I was indicating earlier about the 6%, that seems a nice round figure, and it's going to, I think you had indicated, be approximately $10 a year, so it wouldn't be a steep increase, but it would be very helpful for, as Bob had indicated, on the capital replacement. Councilman Mihalovich?
Back to the revenue. Didn't we project a downward in the franchise and utility taxes where this would, that's where the revenue item exists, right?
That's correct. It would be in the franchise and utility tax.
Okay. And so do we're projecting that it be down again?
The likelihood is there because of the cell phone tax is typically one of those items where it's trending down in that particular category quite significantly from where we would have been last year or where we would have been this year. And then along with that, the gas utility taxes is probably, it's up from what we budgeted last year, but probably lower from what it had been 2 years ago. So we've seen kind of a trend downwards there. And that's because Ameren had to reduce the gas utility rate, so for citizens, because of a legal hearing, so, which is good. So,
well, having that as a trend line and having the discussion in 1982 as 6.55, it seems like the discussion needs to go forward. I'm not going to make that motion because I will not be at the Monday meeting, so that'd be unfair for me. However, I would support us looking at that through a hearing, and also support us putting a amount that we would anticipate this would bring, because the discussion is already centered around the capital improvements and capital replacement and our buildings and the fund to maintain our buildings and fleet. So it kind of, the caveat is I'm for us investigating it. If we do decide to go that direction, I'm for putting that money directly towards the capital improvements.
And could I, maybe I need to correct something I said, and I'm okay if the council makes a motion and says to do it, but and maybe I don't need a strong desire, but I just want to make sure that the council's okay with staff putting out more information about this for the public hearing and encouraging input. That's what I was looking for, so, because again, as I said before, it's something typically we don't have a lot of folks, if any, show up to. So.
Councilman Hussey.
Back to Councilman Mihalovich on the trend line, if I recall, wasn't some of that weather related? as well, like 15 was down, because 14 was tougher on temperature-wise. Yep. There was just a higher usage.
Right.
And so thank you on that. And I don't disagree with your point. I think philosophically the council could say that, but, you know, we couldn't necessarily restrict those funds in the future. I mean, we could, in 2 or 3 years, a new council could choose to do something different with that increase. And so while I think that's our intent, I think we got to be careful about making sure we don't state that it's going to be dedicated to a particular purpose, because that could get misconstrued that this is a capital fund. You may not have the answer to some of these questions, but I'm curious, when we talk about the residential rate increase, $250 a month, it's $10, but I'm curious, do we have any idea in terms of that total tax, how much of it is paid by residential versus how much of it is paid by commercial industry business in this town?
We do not.
Okay.
But not for lack of trying.
Okay.
If I can leave it at that.
Because my guess will be that, you know, a few dollars on a residence over the course of a year, if it's $8, $10, $12, whatever the case may be, is a little bit easier. But my guess is the big payers of this, you know, in terms of their large users, the box stores, the major industries, manufacturing, you know, that's probably the people we also need to make sure get this message as well about the meeting, to because it really impacts their bottom line if we've increased their tax by a couple $1,000 a month.
Mr. Betts, can you get that information out? Will you be able to get that information out on what Councilman Hussey was just talking about?
Yeah, I think you mean to send it to the businesses or whatnot to let them know? And
I should clarify, not a couple thousand a month, a couple $100 a month.
Yeah, there you go. That's correct. But, yeah, I mean, we'll do our best to let as many folks know. It should be pointed out that there are 4 businesses in town that are actually capped. They have an agreement with the city that's in place to where they're capped on how much utility they can pay. And I can send that out as well, who those 4 are, because I cannot remember who they are off the top of my head.
And so this estimate takes that into account then?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yep. Councilman Scribner?
Yes, I just wanted to say I think we should invite, in fact, it was my intention, and, you know, the old adage about good intentions, but it was my intention to talk to Randy Allen and Sean about the impact that they would see and what their concerns might be about an increase in this. And I think we should invite Randy, and I'll be happy to give him a call. I think if he could be here next Monday for that hearing, he would
we'll
be
make sure
someone that we need
invite,
to make sure
see if he can make it.
Is here. And then just in regard to the larger users, you know, I have no idea if we have any users whose bill exceeds $100,000 a month, but your chart here shows that someone who has a combined electric and gas bill of $100,000 a month would, at 6%, would see an increase of about $4,200. So while that's not chump change, on a $100,000 a month bill, $4,200 annual increase is not, you know, that's $1.2 million bill with a $4,200 increase is not probably real significant to a business of that size. I guess it's not for me to decide if that's significant or not.
Any other discussion? Councilman Graham.
I guess I just have to say this. I think, Councilman Scribner, you and I had this conversation last week about this, and I guess just wanted to have a discussion about an increase in this, just to have a discussion. So I'm just be curious to see how many people come out to this hearing on Monday. And I guess my biggest concern, I mean, I know we say that, you know, it's $10, $8 a year, may not be that much, but for some people, that is a lot. And I know we're getting ready to go into sales tax G for next year with that campaign and asking for, you know, not an increase in taxes, but to maintain what we have is a big concern that I have. Certainly, I welcome the conversation that we're going to have on next week, but that's just my biggest concern as it relates to an increase into this GRUT tax and then trying to campaign for sales tax G all within a year's time is a big concern that I have. So that's just my thoughts, but I am open to and look forward to hearing from our constituents on next Monday. So that's just my personal thoughts.
Councilman Scrivener.
If I could respond for just a moment, I think all of us share that same concern. I mean, everyone is concerned about it. And I guess if I were approached, I mean, I don't know what my position would be on raising it, to tell you the truth at this point, but if I were to vote to raise it and I were asked to justify that by a member of the public, I guess my response would be to try to relate to them how hard we've worked in the last couple of years to try to cut expenses and trim any areas of inefficiencies or areas left positions unfilled and stretched, extended the life of equipment and used some equipment even perhaps beyond what we might consider its useful life. And so it's not like we're coming with a lot of excess and saying we want to increase the excess. We're coming saying, hey, we've done everything we know how to do, everything that we've been able to identify that would best make use of taxpayer money, and we've still come up short. And we're still unable to fund the replacement equipment. We can fund operations from existing revenue, but to fund the needed and necessary equipment to perform the services that people expect us to perform, we haven't figured out any way to do it. And that's why I support Councilman Mihaljevic's and we've had these discussions among ourselves, and we would both be, if we supported it, we would be supportive from the standpoint that as long as we have anything to do with it, the money would be spent on this capital replacement, not on personnel, not on things that might be considered the operations of the city, but on the foundation of the replacement products or replacement that needs to be addressed. I mean, we've got an ever-growing liability there, and we need to start nibbling away at that thing, and even more than nibbling, we need to take some substantial steps to whittle that down, or it's going to become a crisis. And so that would be how I would approach trying to justify to someone who came up to me and asked me why I would do something like that, because it's not in my nature to support tax increases.
Councilman Mihaljevic.
Well, and the thing that grabs me is this sheet right here, and especially this item in the middle, which is the purple area, is not really being addressed. Except to the extent that we're having $44,000 in lease payments to accomplish a couple hundred thousand in whittling this down. This even got worse after a previous finance meeting. This was brought to, and then we look at it again, and there's this sinking fund for buildings that weren't included. And I've had some staff say we've really woefully underfunded buildings and repair, and we saw a presentation from the fire departments and the buildings there. And next year, using this model, is $1.4 million in capital replacement needs. That, I don't know where we're going to come up with $1.4 million. We got to start sometime, and I'd like to sit on a council that starts this budget session to start addressing some of this. And I know our current budget does start addressing it through lease payments, and that's one option. I, for one, think it ties the hands of future councils, but that debate's still yet to come amongst this group. So that's my two cents.
Last statement I'll make.
Councilman
Graham. For me, timing is everything.
All right. Any other questions or comments? We do have a closed session following us, so we'll have to take a motion to adjourn before we go into there. So if there's any other questions regarding any of the topics tonight, anything else, please bring it up now.
Move for adjournment.
All right. It's been moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those against? Passes.